Good evening, everyone. What a blessing to be in the house of God again. We want to thank the Lord for the opportunity of coming together to study God out of his word. Every night is a very special night. This coming week, we're going into a whole different level. And so you got to hold on. Come on, say amen. This is not a sprint. This is a marathon. Amen. But we want to give God the praise and the glory and the honor. Let me see the hands of those who are here for your first time tonight. You've been here for the very first time tonight. Raise your hand. First time, you're brand new. Okay. Thank you so much for taking the time. Now, I want you to turn around and shake the person's hand beside you, behind you, in front of you. Tell them who you are and let them tell you who they are and welcome them into the place tonight. Let us pray as we open up the word. Father, we just pause tonight. We want to thank you in advance for allowing us to come here safely. And God, as we've come to share, we pray that your spirit will take full control, bless us as only you can, work with us as only you can. Then God, at the end, we pray that we will give you the honor and the glory and the praise because you are worthy and you thought we were worth it. Thank you so much for using this small spoke in a big wheel. Then hide me behind the cross. Let people not see me, but let them hear from you. And God, we pray that clarity will be given tonight so that we'll understand your word and be obedient to what you say. In Jesus' name, amen. So Sunday night, we dealt with the devil being chained to the bottomless pit. And we learned something very special in that scenario. We went back and we dealt with the fact that Christ's second coming, when he comes, those who are alive and remain shall be caught up. Amen. The righteous who are asleep in the grave will be resurrected. Amen. The wicked who are on the earth shall be slain by the brightness of his coming. The cities are broken down. Everything is just all messed up. Hail has fallen about the size of a talent, which is from 75 pounds to 150 pounds. Cities are broken down. And as far as your eyes could see, bodies are strewn all over the place. And the devil has to handle a morgue for 1,000 years. None is buried. None is put away. And they're there. And that begins the 1,000-year reign. That's the 1,000-year of the devil. I call him in timeout. But at the end of the day, it ends. Revelation, the 20th chapter, says it ends. And the devil goes out to actually begin to deceive those from the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog. And he is gathering them to do something. And that is to attack the holy city. Now, we found out very carefully that God has done something for us. John 14:1-3, it says, let not your what? Be troubled. He believe in what? Believe also in who? And he says, in my Father's house or what? If it were not so, I would have what? He says, I go and what? Prepare a place for you. And if I do what? Go and prepare a place for you. He says, I will what? I will come again and receive you unto myself that what? Where I am, there ye may be also. In other words, Christ has gone to prepare a place for us. And tonight we're going to deal with that place. And we're going to deal with it from the perspective that makes not only sense, but when you look at it through the word of God, you say, wow, you know, that makes 100% sense. Let me just throw this out because I can. If there's a resurrection at Christ's second coming, When people say a person dies and goes straight to heaven, why is Christ coming to resurrect if they're already in heaven? Just want you to think about that. Because later on, we're going to deal with the keys of death. And we're going to unpack all of that. And you'll find out that what the Bible says about it is different than what we've been saying about it. So God's going to help us clear that up. Because if there's a resurrection at a second coming and the dead in Christ gets up, if a person dies and goes straight to heaven, there's no need for what? Resurrection. So that theory, you're going to see it. So many things that we just, you know, we've been just thinking and talking about stuff all of our lives, but we've not gone back to the word to verify what God says. So we just want you to hold on to your seat. So tonight we're dealing with the amazing space city. And I want you to just come with me for a moment. So he said he's gone to prepare a place for you, for us. And he promises to come again. So this space city is the place that God has gone to prepare for us. It's called our what? It's called our heavenly home. And I want you to understand that when you look very carefully, Hebrews 11th chapter and verse 16 says something powerful. Hebrews 11 and verse 16.
But now they desire a better country.
Okay.
That is a heavenly, wherefore God is not ashamed to be called their God.
Okay.
For he hath prepared for them a city.
Okay. So here it is. The writer of Hebrews says everyone that has been pursuing and trying to do God's will, they're actually looking for that city, a heavenly city that God has prepared for his people. And so tonight I want you to understand, it says what?
What has God prepared for his people?
What has God prepared for his people? And it says it's what? A city. I want you to understand that I went to Utah maybe a couple of years ago. Well, I've been through Utah on the way to Canada, but this is the first time I went actually to Utah. And when you're landing in Utah, it looks like the moonscape. It really looks like the moonscape. You look like, okay, where am I landing? But it has everything you could think about looking like the moon, craters and all that stuff. So you're landing there and you're saying, wow, this is interesting. Well, very, very clean city. Beautiful place. Nice structure. They do a lot. They treated me real well. Didn't see a lot of my kind, but nice place. But a beautiful city. Let me see this in the hands of those who've been to a city that was so beautiful that you just had to just say, wow. Okay, what city was that? Where? Tokyo. Okay. Any other one had a city that just blew you away? My brother just came from Dubai. And he says, Godwin, he says, man. He said, that place. Another hand? Someone saw it? Another hand? Yes. To where? Las Vegas. Okay. Okay. Aruba. Okay. Beautiful. Aruba has 365 different beaches. A beach for every day of the year. Aruba. My grandmother grew up in Aruba. I've never been there. But that's on my mom's side. But the reality is, I understand it's a beautiful place. I've seen pictures of it. I hadn't gone yet. Amen. But beautiful place. But God has prepared for us a city. And I want you to understand, what we need to understand tonight is Revelation chapter 3 and verse 12 says, it asks the question, what is the what? The name of the city. Revelation 3 and verse 12. Let's read that. It says what?
Him that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of my God.
Uh-huh.
And he shall go no more out.
Uh-huh.
And I will write upon him the name of my God.
Okay.
And the name of the city of my God.
Which is what?
Which is New Jerusalem.
Have mercy.
Which cometh down out of heaven from my God. And I will write upon him my new name.
Amen. So here it is. John the Revelator declares that the name of that city is what?
New Jerusalem.
New Jerusalem. Why do you think it's called the New Jerusalem? Huh? He said the old one got messed up. That is correct. And because the old Jerusalem still have us around, still have sin and sinners, right? But when he actually opens up this door and you see heaven come down to earth and the New Jerusalem comes here, that is God starting it all over. In the beginning, God created the heaven and earth, Genesis chapter 1 says. And I want you to understand is God is going to do it again. He's going to do it what?
Again.
He's going to do it again. We look very carefully and we're going to learn some things tonight. Three, ask what?
What happened to the New Jerusalem at the close of the 1,000 years of Revelation 20?
So at the close of the 1,000 years of Revelation 20, something happens. And the Bible paints it in Revelation 20, chapter 21.
Verse 2 and 10.
And we're going to start with verse 1. It says what?
And I saw a new heaven.
And I saw a what?
A new heaven and
a new earth. And what happened?
For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away.
And what happened?
And there was no more sea.
And what happened?
And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride, adorned for her husband.
Here it is. God is laying it out. He said, and I want you to think in terms of this. So we talked about two resurrections, right? We talked about the resurrection that happens when Christ comes the second time. Amen. That's called the first resurrection. Amen. And those who get up in the first resurrection, on them, the second death hath no power. But between the 1,000 years, when Christ comes, that starts the 1,000 years, he takes us home, and we're actually priests of God and kings, and we reign for him with him 1,000 years, and we're actually going over what? The records. Judgment has begun. And we get a chance to see why or if a person was lost, what was the reason, all that, so that eventually God can wipe away all
tears
from our eyes. We're going to be satisfied that what we see matches up with what God says. And we'll see how he tried every bit to save folk, and they chose not to be saved. But here it is, in the thousand, between the 1,000 years, you have two items that happen. At the end of the 1,000 years, we say that the what? It comes down what?
To earth.
The New Jerusalem comes down to earth. And John describes it as a bride adorned for a husband. I don't know if anybody ever saw the picture I had some 43 years ago when I was standing waiting for my wife to come down the aisle. Some people said his eyes were closed. Now, I was meditating. But she was looking so pretty, and she was coming down the aisle. And I almost choked up. In fact, I lost my voice a few days before my wedding, and my mother-in-law was putting a lemon juice and honey. She says, "You gonna say I do?" I lost my voice, and Mama was there just making sure I had that stuff in my system. She said, "You gonna say I do?" And so. But to see her coming down as a bride adorned for her husband, it just took my breath away. I still look at her and I still tell her, I said, good. I let her know, I said, "Girl, you better stop that." Looking good. But at the end of the day, the New Jerusalem comes down as a bride adorned for her husband. And I want you to understand that God puts all the bells and whistles in place in the book of Zechariah, it actually talks about what happens in the 14th chapter, looking at verse 1, verse 4, and verse 5 and 10. It talks about the scenario that happens. When Christ comes and brings the holy city down, something happens. Something happens. It's a geographic place in the nation, in the world. He comes down on the Mount of what?
Olives.
What is special about the Mount of Olives? Think about it for a second. When he left here, where did he go from? Mount of Olives. He was going to, and he's had many times to do a lot of ministry at the Mount of Olives. But the Bible talks about very carefully, and that's Zechariah.
Zechariah 1 says, "Behold, the day of the Lord cometh, and thy spoil shall be divided in the midst of thee."
Okay.
4 says, "And his feet shall stand in that day upon the Mount of Olives,"
okay,
"which is before Jerusalem on the east."
Okay.
"And the Mount of Olives shall cleave,"
okay,
"in the midst thereof toward the east and toward the west. And there shall be a very great valley, and half of the mountain shall remove toward the north, and half of it toward the south." And verse 5 says, "And ye shall flee to the valley of the mountains, for the valley of the mountains shall reach until Azal. Yea, ye shall flee, like as ye fled from before the earthquake in the days of Uzzah, king of Judah. And the Lord my God shall come, and all the saints with thee." Last but not least, 10 says, "All the land shall be turned as a plain from Geba to Rimmon, south of Jerusalem, and it shall be lifted up and inhabited in her place from Benjamin's gate unto the place of the first gate, unto the corner gate, and from the tower of Hanal unto the king's wine presses."
So here it is. He levels out a plain, and that is where the New Jerusalem is going to be parked. But I want you to understand, simultaneously with this happening, there is a resurrection. Who is resurrected? At the end of the 1,000 years, who's resurrected?
Evil.
The wicked. The wicked. They are resurrected at the end of the 1,000 years, and they actually see this phenomenon. And the devil goes out because he's loose, because he has now people to actually persuade. And he goes out in throughout the nations, and he's gathering them for battle. He wants to take the city. He wants to take the city. Revelation 20th chapter talks about the fact that when he tried to do that, fire comes down. We will read that. We'll get there. But I want you to understand that the New Jerusalem comes down, and where are the saints? Where are the saints? Thank you. They're in the city. They're in the city. Who's outside of the city? The wicked. Tell somebody, say, "You need to be on the inside." Tell somebody, "You need to be on the inside. Don't you be on the outside. You need to be inside the city." Inside the city. Don't be on the outside. That will be too late if you're on the outside. And so here, the site that actually lays out as a plain is right there, the Mount of Olives. I want us to see something. There's a note in question number 4. There's a note in question number 4. Or is it in question number 5?
Uh-huh.
5. Okay. So it says here what? The city is what?
Perfectly square.
Perfectly square.
What is the
what
distance?
What is the what?
The distance around the city.
Around the city. What does Revelation 21 and 16 say? Revelation 21, 16. Let's read that. It says what? Okay, the length is as large as the breadth. And how many furlongs?
12,000 furlongs.
12,000 furlongs. And it's perfectly square. So is as long as it is wide, as it is deep. It's a huge city. There's a note in number 5 that tells you how large it is. I'm going to ask Elder King to read that note. Listen to this.
Ancient cities were measured by outside wall circumference. A furlong is an eighth of a mile, which means that the city would have a circumference of 1,500 miles. And since it is square, each wall would be 375 miles in length. It will contain 140,625 square miles, which is more area than Virginia, District of Columbia, Pennsylvania, Maryland, New Jersey, Rhode Island, and Vermont combined. It is unbelievably gigantic. At least 39 million people could live in the city, and this is 10 times the world's present population.
Could you imagine that? A city so large that you're going to have plenty of space. Come on, say amen. Could you imagine that? A city perfectly made by God. He's gone to prepare a place for us. And what a place this is going to be. And you know what? We came to back to North Carolina, and we were trying to find a house. And the lady said to us, you know, we'll take you around. We did that. Well, on my birthday, my wife was away and taking care of her mom. And so I said, I'm going to go golfing. So I grabbed my stuff, and there was a phone call made. And she said, I know you think you're going golfing today. She said, but you need to find a house. And you need to find it before I get back. So I called the realtor. I said, hey, look, I got some free time. Let's run again. And so we went and we looked and we looked and looked and we found a house. And the realtor said, I said to the realtor, I said, this is the house. She said, Mr. Mitchell, your wife hasn't seen it. I said, yes, she has. And she says, what do you mean, yes, she has? I said, my wife and I have the exact same taste. I know what she likes. There's no doubt about it. And I said, go ahead, I'll put some money down and let's close this deal. And she said, but Mr. Mitchell, she hasn't seen it. I said, you don't understand. My wife and I have the same taste. I know what she likes. Let's go ahead and make the deal. So we did that. Yassie came and she walked through the house. She said, oh, I love it. This is so nice. Oh, yeah. And she was just like, but I know what she likes. You know what God does? God created a place just for us. He knows what we like. And so when you walk through the place, you're going to say, oh, Jesus, I love it. This is so nice. There's a jacuzzi here. Come on, say amen. There's a sunroom here, and you shine in as the sun. Come on, say amen. Oh, look at that. Look at that. Woo! Hanging gardens. Look at that. You're going to be ahhing and oohing, and you're going to praise God. Why? Because God knows how to bless us. He knows exactly what we really like. You. He's going to hook this place up. That when you walk in, you're going to say, eyes have not seen, nor ear has heard, neither has it even entered into the heart of man the things that God has prepared for those that love him. It's going to blow you away because God is that way. He goes all the way. Come on, say amen. Amen. It's going to be tight. That little matchbox I have. I like my little matchbox, though. Come on, say amen. In comparison to what he's going to do? Oh, my goodness. You can't compare it. What a blessing. What a blessing. So here in Revelation, it talks about the city's dimension, and it could hold how many times the world's population? 10 times?
10 times.
10 times. And I want you to understand, this is going to be a city. What a wonderful place. And it's what God has prepared for us. Come on, say amen. But I want you to understand, this is an architect's dream. This city. Could you imagine streets of gold? Could you imagine walls of jasper? Could you imagine gates of pearl? Could you imagine every type of precious stone that you could think of? He has it all around. And that's why bad folk can't make it in, because somebody would dig up the streets of gold. Hey, man. Pookie. Hey, Pookie. It's gold, man. Try to do a jackhammer. You know what I'm talking about? You can't do that. Boy, we're going to walk streets of gold. Come on, say man. You ain't got time to dig up no gold. Come on, say man. Oh, have mercy. An architect's dream. So what else does the book of Revelation say about this amazing city? The Bible says in Revelation 21, let's look at verse 10. And let's also look at 10 through 27.
10 says, he carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain and showed me that great city, the holy Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from God. 11 says, and having the glory of God, her light was like unto a stone most precious, even like a jasper stone, clear as crystal. And had a wall great and high, and had 12 gates.
Have mercy.
And at the gates, 12 angels.
Have mercy.
And names written thereon, which were the names of the 12 tribes of the children of Israel. On the east, 3 gates. On the north, 3 gates. On the south, 3 gates. On the west, 3 gates. And the wall of the city had 12 foundations. Mm. And in them, the names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb.
Have
mercy. And he that talked with me had a golden reed to measure the city, and the gates thereof, and the wall thereof, and the city lieth four square, and the length is as large as the breadth. And he measured the city with the reed 12,000 furlongs. The length and the breadth and the height of there are equal. He measured the wall thereof, and 140 and 4 cubits, according to the measure of a man, that is of the angel. And the building of the wall of it was jasper, and the city was pure gold, like unto clear glass, and the foundations of the wall of the city were garnished with all manner of precious stones.
Have mercy.
The first foundation was jasper, the second sapphire, the third, I can't pronounce, the fourth emerald, the fifth sardox, the sixth sardius, the seventh crystallite, the eighth beryl, the ninth topaz, the tenth the 11th genic, and the 12th amethyst.
Okay.
And the 12 gates were 12 pearls. Every several gate was one pearl. And the street of the city was pure gold, and it was transparent glass.
Have mercy. So here it is. The city is decked out. Come on, say amen. Could you imagine having a place and people give you the key to a place like that? And they tell you, it's free. You have no mortgage. It is your own house. But you know what's nice about this study tonight? That is what Christ has gone to prepare for us. But he's going to let us prepare something ourselves. Oh, you didn't hear me. Have you ever heard of a city home and a country home? We're going to have it that way. What a blessing. So here it is. It says,
it has the glory of God.
It has the glory of God. What else does it have?
The wall is made of jasper.
And wall made of jasper and what?
144 cubits high.
Okay. Okay, what else?
It has 12 gates, 3 on each side.
12 gates, 3 on. Now, let me ask you a question. How many gates do you need? But you got 12 gates, 3 in the north, 3 in the south, 3 in the east, 3 in the west. Man, you can go in and out of gates, man. You see, God wants you to know that it's open. It's open. Amen. And each gate is made of a single pearl. You know how big that is? One pearl. That must be some huge oyster, huh? But you know, I studied about the pearls and I found out that pearls only happen through trial and struggle. Whatever irritation comes into that oyster, that pearl spends its time letting out its nectar and luster and covers and covers and covers until he actually gets rid of that thing. And even when you have these worms that bore through the oyster, that oyster will turn that and turn that and turn that, and that enemy will become petrified and hardened. And that oyster will keep turning and turning until that enemy is entombed in a pearl. See, the struggle that we would have gone through, God says, I'm going to let you walk through gates of pearl. You hung on in there. You did not give up. No matter how hard it got, walk in through these gates. What a symbolism of struggle personified by victory, by overcoming. Come on, say amen. Gates of pearl. What else did it have?
The city has 12 foundations.
12 foundations. And what?
Made of a precious stone.
12 foundations. What a beautiful place. What else?
Streets are made of pure gold.
Streets are made of pure gold. What else?
No need of sun or moon.
No need for sun or the what?
Or moon.
Why?
God's going to be the light.
God's going to be the light. Amen. And there shall be no what?
There shall be no night there.
There shall be no what?
No night.
Night there. Come on, say amen. You're not going to say I'm tired. Let me see the hands of those who hit that age that you got to sit down sometime. So you may be working hard and all of a sudden you say, hey, man, I just need to sit down. You tired. But there will not be any night there. You won't even say you're tired. God's going to make us brand new. Come on, say amen. What a blessing it's going to be. Tonight, I want you to see something. It says, what is the what?
Source of the city's water supply.
Okay, the Bible says in Revelation 22nd chapter, let's read that, verse 1.
And he showed me a pure river of water.
Okay.
Of life, clear as crystal.
Where does it come from?
Proceeding out of the throne of God.
Okay.
And of the Lamb.
Okay. So the crystal clear water comes out of the throne of God. Mm-hmm. Now, what did Christ say when he was on earth? Did he not say, I am the water of life? Mm-hmm. Did he not say, I'm the bread of life as well? That's very interesting. Coming out of the throne is the water of life. And he says in Revelation, if you're thirsty, the 22nd chapter, he says, come drink. Drink of the water of life freely. We're going to have a chance to drink of that water. Come on, say amen. And we'll never thirst again. Praise God. What a blessing to know that we could drink off the water of life that proceeds out of the throne of God. And so here it is. It says what?
The river of water of life flows out of God's throne.
Okay. So here it is.
What miraculous tree which Adam and Eve ate before sinning would be restored in the holy city.
Now, Genesis 3 and verse 24. Genesis 3, 24 said something very special. And then we're going to go back to Revelation, the 22nd chapter and verse 2. Genesis 3 and verse 24.
It says that, so he drove out the man and he placed at the east of the garden Eden cherubims.
Okay.
With a flaming sword, which turned every way to keep the way of the tree of life.
Okay, so I want you to understand, when man sinned in Genesis, the third chapter, and sin entered the world, God clothed Adam and Eve with coats of skin. He came and he told them that he was going to come by verse 15 of Genesis, the third chapter. He talks about enmity between the seed of the woman and the seed of the serpent and all that. And he talked about coming. But I want you to understand, he had to put them out. And the Bible says he put cherubims to guard the tree of life. You know why they had to guard the tree of life?
Yes.
Because if Adam and Eve, after sinning, had come and was eaten off the tree of life, they would what? They'll live forever. They'll live forever. But the Bible says in Revelation 22 and verse 2, Revelation 22 by verse 2, it says what?
In the midst of the street of it, and on either side of the river,
is it what?
Was there the tree of life.
Okay, that did what?
Which bare 12 manner of fruits, and yielded her fruit every month, and the leaves of the tree
were for the what?
For the healing of the nation.
Okay, so here is a tree that's blooming and producing 12 different fruit every month. Let me see your favorite. What's your favorite fruit? Someone say watermelon. Okay. Apple. Peaches. Okay. Strawberries. Okay. I like mangoes. Oh, I love mangoes. So, you know, I know one of those is going to be mangoes. But I want you to understand 12 different manner of fruit every month. And then you can eat the leaves for the healing of the nation. What an awesome, awesome time that's going to be. And it's the tree of life. God is going to restore that tree again, and he's going to allow us to eat from it. And folk, let me tell you something. He sustains us, but he gives us back what we lost. Come on, say amen. What a blessing to know that God restores. He gives us back what we've lost. The tree of life, and it's on both sides of the river of life. And you could see the fruit you could eat. And man, let me tell you something. I've had some fruit in my life that I tasted. I said, wow. Went to Costa Rica and they have the sweetest pineapple. Oh. You start, and one guy came to the meeting up in Natalie. We were building a church up there. This guy came, little fella. He had a big mango. I mean, that's the biggest mango I've seen. I was about to hijack him. Come on, say amen. But he gave me that look like, you don't want none of this. Yeah, little fella, you know. But the tastiest fruit you could taste in different places of the world, beautiful, delicious. But it has nothing to do with this. It can't top it. And I want you to understand, God has provided that for us. Now, 9 says what?
The tree of life bears 12 kinds of fruit.
And what?
And yield the crop monthly.
Okay.
What purpose does this tree serve?
Okay, what purpose does this tree serve? It serves what?
The leaves are for the healing of the nation.
Have mercy. The healing of the nation. Whatever is ailing, this tree will help correct it. Come on, say amen. And you know what? Think about it. Think about it. I'm going to throw this out so you'll hear it. God is going back to his original diet. He's going back to what happened when he created man. The flood messed us up. But God is going back to us. Actually, back to the original that he had for mankind from the very beginning. So you see that, and we'll deal with that a little later. But at the end of the day, I want you to understand the blessing is God creates stuff for us to help us and to bless us. It says what?
Lest he take of the tree of life and eat and live forever.
So that tree was taken away from Adam and Eve because if they were to eat it, they will live forever. So this is the question. How what?
How do the things which God is preparing for us compare with the suffering which we must pass through here on earth?
What does Romans 8 and verse 18 say? It says what? It's not worthy to be what? Compared to what? Even the present suffering. Is not worthy to be compared
to this present time.
Okay.
Not worthy to be compared with the glory
that
will be revealed in us.
Have mercy. In other words, whatever we have to go through to get to is going to be worth it.
Amen.
Oh, you didn't hear me. I'm going to say it again. Whatever we have to go through to get to is going to be worth it. So God is going to allow us to go through some stuff. But the optimum word is through. And that word through is the word rough. Have you seen the spelling of through? Right there in that word is rough. But if you talk about through, it talks about getting to the other side of rough. Come on, say amen. So God has put things in place for us.
New world.
We're talking about having a new world.
In question 7, we learned that when the holy city descends to earth at the close of the 1,000 years of Revelation 20, the wicked will be raised and Satan will lead them in an attempt to capture the holy city. What happens to them?
Revelation 20 and verse 9. Let's read that real quickly. Revelation 20 verse 9 says what? And they compassed the what?
Revelation 20 verse 9, mm-hmm. 9 states that, and they went up to the breadth of the earth.
Okay.
And compassed the camp of the saints about.
Uh-huh.
In the beloved city. And fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them.
I told you, if you wake up in a resurrection and you slept 1,000 years too late, you hear charge, you know you got up in the wrong resurrection. Because that's what the devil's going to do. He's going to actually rally everybody to take the city. And see, these folk who got up don't know that that's not Christ. Satan could be like an angel of light. And so he goes around, he says, you know what? They're in there. That's my place. That's my place. They took it by force. That's my place. Let's go get it back. There are more of us. We could take it. But he's wrong. Because only 1/3 of angels went with him. If only 1/3 went with him, how many does God still have?
2/3.
And which is more? 2/3 is more than 1/3. Praise God. And so I want you to understand, fire came down from heaven and it devoured them. It did what?
Devoured.
It burned them up. What does 2 Peter, the 3rd chapter and verse 10 and 11 say? 10. It says what?
2 Peter 3:10 says.
2 Peter 3:10.
The day of the Lord will come as the thief in the night.
In which the what?
In which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise.
And the what?
And the elements shall melt with fervent heat.
The earth also and the works therein shall be burned up. And what else?
Then that all these things shall be dissolved. What manner of person ought ye to be in all holy conversation and godliness?
Okay. So here it is. The day of the Lord is going to come and it's going to burn up. Now, let me ask you a question. In Genesis, around the 6th chapter, you found out that there was a flood. God called Noah to prepare an ark from that point on. And the world was actually deluged with a flood. Noah preached for 120 years. And at the end of it, God called down curtains. He said, okay, so then. And how you know it is a flood? Because the tallest mountains in the world still have sand and seashells. I'm going to say it again. The tallest mountains in the world still has sand and seashells. And the question is, how did they get up there? The world was covered with water. There was a flood. God says it's going to be fire next time. So the skies and the heavens are being reserved. And this ball is going to be on fire. This earth. But we're going to be cool because we're going to be inside the city. Amen. Tell somebody I said inside. Amen. Amen. Don't be outside. And so here it is. What happens?
The elements
shall what?
Melt with fervent heat.
And what else going to happen?
The earth also and the works that are therein shall
be burnt up. It's going to happen, folk. And my friends, I want you to understand, what does God do next? Revelation 21 and verse 1, it says what? And I what?
And I saw a new heaven.
I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the what?
First heaven.
First earth, seven, and the what?
And the first earth was passed away.
And what?
And there was no more sea.
And I, John.
And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, come down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband.
Okay. And so here it is. God does something special. He allows us to see this new creation. What did 2 Peter 3 and verse 13 say?
It says, nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for new heavens and a new earth
wherein dwelleth
righteousness.
Righteousness. So we're looking for a new heaven and new earth. Wherein dwelleth what?
Righteousness.
Righteousness. We're praising God for that. He what? Creates a new what?
Heavens.
Heaven and a new what?
New earth. Wherein dwelleth.
Dwelleth what? What a blessing to know that. So 14 says what? What?
Where will God live after the holy city becomes the capital of the earth?
Watch what it says in verse 3 of Revelation, the 21st chapter. And it says what? Behold what?
And so declares that to him that overcometh, I will grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame, and I will sit down with my Father in his throne.
Revelation 21, 3.
Oh,
Revelation 21, 3.
I'm sorry.
I heard a great voice out of heaven saying what? The tabernacle of God is with who?
Man.
And what's going to happen?
Behold.
He will dwell with them and what?
He will dwell with them.
And they shall be his people, and God himself shall what?
Be with them.
Dwell with them and be what?
God.
In other words, could you imagine God is shifting the center of his universe from heaven to the same planet that walked him up Golgotha's hill and put a crown of thorns on his head, spat in his face and killed him. And he died for us anyway, but he loves us so much. He says, I am moving in. I love you so much. I'm moving my center of the universe here. And I want you to understand, we're going to deal with the four horsemen on tomorrow night. But I want you to understand that everything that God is doing is setting us up to be blessed. Come on, say amen. Everything. He's blessing us, folks. And we need to understand that he's done everything in his power to help us here on earth. He's going to be with his people. Amen. And what a blessing to know that God is hanging out with us. Come on, say, he came and hung out with us when we sinned. For God so loved the world that he did what? Gave his only begotten son that whosoever what?
Believeth.
Should not perish, but have what?
Everlasting life.
So God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. John, the 14th chapter, verse 2 and 3, talks about what?
In my Father's house are many mansions.
If it were not what?
If it were not so, I would have told you.
What happened?
I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, ye may be also.
What a blessing to know that God has done that for us. And so it says what? Real what? Okay, real heaven and what?
Real people.
Real people. Let me see the hands of those who heard that you're going to be in heaven on a cloud strumming a harp. Hey, nobody wants to throw up their hand. Like I ain't put my hand up that. Yeah, some folk have the concept that when we get to heaven, we're gonna be on clouds floating all day strumming harps. We're gonna be spirits walking through stuff and all this. But heaven is a real place for real people. So 16 asks, what kind of bodies will the people who enter into God's kingdom have? What did Philippians say in the third chapter in verse 20 and 21.
For our conversation is in heaven, whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall our body
into what?
That it may be fashioned like unto his glorious body, according to the working whereby he is able to even subdue all things unto himself.
So our bodies will be like his body. And what type of body did he have, by the way? He had what? Okay. After the resurrection, what kind of body did he have? He had what? He had a glorious body, but it was what?
Flesh and bones.
Flesh and bones. He actually had flesh and bones. So we're not going to be just a spirit, meandering. We actually are going to have our presence, our substance. And guess what? I'm going to know you and you're going to know me. Oh. 1 Corinthians, the 13th chapter covers that. Amen. We're going to know even as we are known, right? What did Isaiah, the 6th chapter and verse 5?
Isaiah
65:17.
Thus said, for behold, I create new heavens and a new earth, and the former shall not be remembered, nor come into mind. Verse 21 says, and they shall build houses.
Build what?
Build houses.
Houses and plant what?
And inhabit them. And they shall plant vineyards.
Vineyards
and eat the fruit of them. They shall not build and another inhabit. They shall not plant and another eat. For as the days of a tree are the days of my people, and mine elect shall long enjoy the work of their hands.
When we moved from New York to Florida on 16 acres of land, my parents took us out of the city into the boonies. It was so dark out there, you had to ship daylight. Really. I'm going to tell you how dark it was. One night, Gassie and I were down in Redick, Florida, at my parents' home. And we were back in the back room. And we'd built this nice place for mom and dad. And we were back in the back room. And all of a sudden, I said, Gassie. She says, what? I said, I can't see you. I said, where are you? She was laying right next to me. It was so dark. When them street lights go off, and it was so dark. I was scared to move. That's dark, folk. That's dark. And I'm saying to my wife, where? And my eyes couldn't even adjust. I couldn't see nothing. It's almost like I was blind. I couldn't see nothing. And she said, I told you about the country life here. We laugh about that so hard. But my friends, we're going to be able to plant and reap. My dad, he began to plant trees. And he said, if I don't eat it, my children, my grandchildren will. Well, Lord bless both of them to live long enough to reap and eat from what they planted. Vineyards and all kind of stuff. They did grapes and muscadines, and he planted all kind of stuff. Sorrel bushes coming down the driveway. Some folk gonna get it in a while. everything, peas, everything. But at the end of the day, Isaiah says we're gonna be able to build and plant. We're gonna be able to do all of that. It says what?
They shall build houses and
houses and what?
Inhabit them.
So that's where I'm talking about a city house and a country house. The city house is in the city where Christ prepared for us. But we're going to be able to build our own house. Could you imagine that? You have two places. When you head to the city, you have a place. And when you're out in the country, you have a place. And it's free. Come on, say amen. Amen, amen, amen. And what happened?
They shall plant vineyards and eat the fruit of them.
Okay. What else it says? 19 says what?
How does Paul describe the glories of God's new kingdom? 1 Corinthians 2:9.
He says what?
He says, but as it is written, I have not seen,
nor what?
Nor ear heard.
Neither has it what?
Entered into the heart of man.
The things that what?
Which God has prepared for them that love him.
So I have not seen, neither ear have heard, neither has it what? Enter into the what?
Heart of man.
Heart of man, the things that God has prepared for those that love him. So it's almost like you ain't seen nothing yet. God's got the best thing. He's got the best situation. And I've seen some places. I really have seen some places. And they're nice. But you cannot compare that to what God has for us. Amen? So know what?
Disease or death.
No disease or death. Let me see the hands of those who want to say praise God for that. No disease or death. What does Revelation 20 say?
What comforting and exciting facts about heaven are emphasized in the following.
Okay. Following is what?
Packages.
Okay.
Packages.
Okay. Revelation 21 and verse 4 says what?
Revelation 21
verse and verse 4. It says what?
It says, and God shall wipe away all
tears. God shall what?
Shall wipe away all tears.
Wipe
from
away
their
all tears. And what else?
And there shall be no more death.
No more death. No what?
Sorrow.
No sorrow. No what?
Crying.
No what?
Neither shall there be any more pain.
Why?
For the former things are passed away.
And he that sat on the throne said what?
Wipe away all tears from your eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying. I'm sorry, I'm reading it again. And he that sat upon the throne said
what?
I make all
things what?
He said unto me, write,
for these words are
true and faithful.
So I want you to know that when God says he's going to do it, he does exactly that. Amen? Let's go back for a second. Let's go back for a second. Let's go back for a second. So in Isaiah 65, verse 25, Isaiah 65, 25, what does it say? It says what? Isaiah 65, 25. This is a whole litany of things that's going to happen.
It says that.
The what?
The wolf and the lamb shall feed together.
Okay.
And the lion shall eat straw like the bullock.
Have mercy.
And dust shall be the serpent's meat. They shall not hurt nor destroy in all my holy mountain, saith the Lord.
Have mercy. So lion's going to eat straw. Okay. Lion and leopard going to lay down together. A little child going to lead them. What does Isaiah 11 and verse 6 say? Isaiah 11 and 6 says what? Isaiah 11, 6 says what?
They'll declare that the wolf also shall dwell with the lamb.
Okay.
And the leopard shall lie down with the kid and the calf and the young lion and the fatling together. And the little child shall lead them.
Have mercy. Isn't that amazing? You're not going to have animals killing each other and killing people. They're going to be calm. And could you imagine curling up with a lion? I'm talking about lions and tigers and bears. Oh, my. Could you imagine curling up with a lion and you just, hey, come on, go ahead. You wrestling with a lion and he ain't biting you? Yeah, my pet, yeah. Could you imagine all those animals that were wild and vicious and the snake eating dust? That's his meal now. He ain't saying, pss, 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 pss. You know what? I'm just going to be honest. Let me be transparent. I don't know why he going to have a snake up in there. I said it. I said it. I wanted to say that before, but you know, I don't like snakes. But, you know, if he said they're going to eat dust, praise God. Amen. How about the eyes of the blind? They're going to what? They're going to be open. Come on, say amen. How about the lame? What's going to happen? The ears of the deaf will what?
Shall be unstopped.
Shall be unstopped, Isaiah says in the 35th chapter, verse 5. What else?
Lame man will leap.
Leap like a what? Heart. Watch that. I don't care what is happening. You, I got a brace on, man, at my knee. Man, I got a little you know, I gotta put a little something to stabilize me. Amen. But one day I'm gonna take that off. Come on, say amen. That's from playing that basketball. But what else? It says to what?
The tongue of the dumb shall sing.
Those who can't speak are going to sing. Come on, say amen. And what else?
God will wipe away all tears.
Amen. What a blessing to know that he's going to make everything new. And there'll be what?
No more death.
No more death.
Sorrow.
No, sorrow. No
crying what? Or pain.
Or pain. Come on, say amen. What a blessing to know that he makes everything brand new.
Beast will not hurt nor destroy.
Amen. Amen. What a blessing to know that he does all of that for us. And what else?
The wolf, the leopard, and lion will be led by a little child.
Wow. 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 What a time that's going to be. Says what?
What promises hath God given about heaven that applies to the tragedies of this present earth?
And this is mind-boggling because in Isaiah, the 65th chapter and verse 17, it tells us how God is going to do this thing.
For behold, I create new heavens and a new earth, and the former shall not be remembered.
The former shall not be what?
Remembered.
Remembered, nor what?
Nor come into mind.
Could you imagine that? Whatever you went through, God says, you're not going to even remember it. Neither will it even come into your mind. I don't care what you went through. I don't care what hurt you went through. God says, when I do what I do for you, you're going to be set. All the trauma and all the drama you went through is done. Amen. And you have eternity to enjoy the rest of your time. Come on, say amen. Eternity. That's awesome. Eternal what?
Joy and health.
Amen. It says the prophet
Isaiah gives us three more marvelous promises regarding the new earth. What are they?
Isaiah 35, 1, Isaiah 33, 24, and Isaiah 60 and verse 18. Okay, let's see what they are.
The desert shall blossom as a rose.
The desert shall blossom as a rose. What else?
The inhabitant shall not say, I am sick.
Have mercy. There'll be no sickness there. Come on, say amen. What else?
Violence shall no more be heard in the land.
Have mercy. Have mercy. Have mercy. No crazy folk around. Come on, say amen. Trying to take folk out. Will 23 people, says, with what?
Will people recognize each other in heaven or will we lose identity?
What does 1 Corinthians 13th chapter and verse 12? This is a love chapter. It says, I what? Talks about, then shall I what? Know.
As I am known.
Even as I am
known.
Known. In other words, Paul says, when I was a child, I spake as a child. I thought as a child. He said, but when I became a man, I put away all childish things, but he says, then when I see Christ faithfully, he says, then shall I know even as I am known. In other words, you're going to know each other. Amen. You're going to know your family members, those that died and were resurrected. What a time that's going to be. You know, we have a ball when our family get together. Could you imagine the family of all the ages coming together? Wow. That's going to be a time. Amen. Amen. 24 says what?
Eternity is a long time.
Okay.
Will people ever become bored in heaven?
Okay. What does Psalms 16 and verse 11 say? At his right hand, there what? Okay. It says what?
In that presence is
in fullness. That presence is what?
Fullness of joy.
And what? And that at thy what? Didn't say his right hand. Are we there?
No.
Okay. He says, in his presence of what? Fullness of joy. And what else?
There's pleasure forevermore.
Okay. Okay. And his right hand. Okay. So here it is. No matter how you feel, you're not going to be bored. We got our little granddaughter with us that just flew in from Texas. And we picked up at 1 o'clock in Charlotte. So she's with us. And little Clark was in the car driving back. And she says, "Papa, what are we going to do tomorrow?" She got a schedule. She said, "Well, I want to go to the park. I want to go to water stuff. We're going to have some fun, Papa." So she walked in the house. She went up to the playroom upstairs. And she said, "Papa, can I go?" I said, "Yeah, don't go in the other room. Go in that big playroom. You can play with whatever you need to play, your stove and all that stuff." So they have an area that they play in. So she went up and she was playing for a while. I heard her humming. And she says, "I want to turn on Gabby Dollhouse." Okay. And then I heard her coming. She says, "Is the food ready?" I mean, this girl thinks she's getting room service. You know what I'm talking about? "Is the food ready?" She said, "I smell it. I smell it. Gigi, when's the food ready?" She said, "I'm almost finished." Then she came down. She said, "Do you mind putting it on my plate?" I was about to say, "You go in the pot and put..." No, no. She's four. She's four. But it's like she enjoys, she has a mindset. We're going to have fun up in here. And that's what we have to have when we're talking about being saved eternally. We're going to have some fun up in here. Could you imagine traveling to all the unknown planets? Billions and billions and billions. I'm talking about planets you've never seen before. Talk about traveling, enjoying yourself. What else?
There are pleasures forevermore.
Pleasures forevermore. 25 says what?
Who will the redeemed be like, and who will be their constant companion?
1 John 3 and verse 2. And Revelation 14 and verse 4. It says what?
We shall be like what?
We shall be like him. And what else?
These follow the Lamb wheresoever he goeth.
We are following the Lamb wheresoever he goeth. Now, if you notice in Revelation, the 7th chapter, the 6th chapter ends the seals. But in the 7th chapter, you see an angel coming down, and he actually says to the four angels that were to loose the winds, "Hold the winds, don't let them blow till we have sealed the servants of your God in their foreheads." And it talks about that from the perspective of this. Have you ever heard of an all-star team? Right now, the Olympics are in full swing. Preparation for that. The basketball teams are the best of the best that they get. All of these athletes are the best of the best to go. Think about it from this perspective. John says, I saw there was 144,000. Then he says, "I saw a number that no man could number." He says, "Who are these and where did it come from?" He says, "These are they that have come out of great tribulation and have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb." In other words, when you talk about following the Lamb, we're going to be the all-star team. Oh, you didn't hear me. Let me say it. The redeemed of all ages are going to be like the all-star team. We're going to be going from planet to planet, and Jesus is going to say, you want to hear a story? Tell them. And we're going to be able to tell where we came from and how by the blood of the Lamb God helped us to overcome. We're going to be able to sing and shout and give God some praise. And could you imagine us coming to a planet and people just get up and they stop? Could you imagine planets lining up and they're clapping? Why? Because you made it. I made it. We made it. Why? God is worthy. Oh, that's why I got to serve him. Got to serve him. He's been so good to me. Oh, Jesus, thank you. Sin is what?
One thing that can keep me out of God's kingdom. What can be done about it?
Today, everything. It says what?
The blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us
from what?
All sins.
We've got to plead the blood. We've got to receive his covering. We got to receive his cleansing. He'll do it for us.
Jesus will freely and lovingly cleanse you if you request it. Will you ask him for cleansing right now?
That is our prayer. Lord, help me. Cry like David cried out, create within me, O God, a clean heart, and renew a right spirit within me. Jesus is the anchor for our soul. Let's go and fill out our quiz questions. Let's go as true or false as we go through this tonight.
The name of the glorious city that God made for the redeemed that will travel through space is the New Jerusalem.
That true or false? Put that down.
The streets of that city are made of gold.
Okay. That's number two. Streets of the city is made of gold. True or false?
The wicked are destroyed when they try to take the city, according to Revelation 20.
Okay. The wicked are destroyed. They try to take the city, according to Revelation 20. True or false?
God promises that the tragedies of this present world will not come into the minds of the redeemed after sin is eliminated.
Amen. That's four. And finally, five is what?
Eternity is a long time, and there is the possibility that some might get bored.
Okay. Let's look at this real quickly. The first one says what?
The name of the glorious city that God made for the redeemed that will travel through space is the New Jerusalem.
Amen. Amen. Next one.
The streets of that city are made of gold.
True. Amen. Amen.
The wicked are destroyed when they try to take the city, according to Revelation 20.
Amen. Three, four.
God promises that the tragedies of this present world would not come to the minds of the redeemed after sin is eliminated.
Okay. Amen. And the last one says what?
Eternity is a long time, and there is the possibility that some might get bored.
No way. I praise God for the opportunity of knowing that God has prepared a place for us. Our response questions are these.
If tonight's Bible study brought joy to your heart, put an X in box number one.
Okay. That's box number one. Brought joy to your heart tonight, the lesson.
If you want to thank Jesus for building your home in the New Jerusalem so that you can be in his presence, not only now, but forever, put an X in box number two.
Amen. Amen. And then on tomorrow night, we're going to deal with the what?
Four horsemen.
We're going to deal with the four horsemen of Revelation. And I want you to understand, this is a bodacious study tomorrow night. You don't want them to. You're going to see some stuff up in here. You're going to see some stuff that you're going to say, oh, so that's what that means. But we're looking forward to see you on tomorrow night. And by the way, tomorrow night, when you leave out, by the way, we're going to take up the offering, turn in your cards and stuff right now. We're going to have ushers do that whilst we're speaking. But tomorrow, when you leave here tomorrow, we have a gift to put in your hands. Because the next day is the 4th of July. So we're going to get you some watermelon. So tomorrow night when you go out, it'll be ready. You can take it. Don't eat it up in here. Take it with you. Amen. But we just want to give you a little treat. Enjoy a nice, refreshing slice of watermelon. Amen. So that'll be ready for us. Our crew will have that on tomorrow night, and we'll come back after July 4th. Don't eat too much. Come on, say amen. And we'll come back and deal with on Friday the seal of God. Come on, say amen. But what a blessing. Thank you for coming out night after night. God has a blessing in store for us. And my prayer is that every night we'll come with our hearts open to listen to his word and allow his spirit to do for us that which we cannot do for ourselves. Did you learn something tonight? Amen. Amen. Let's stand as we have our closing prayer.
May you bow our heads, please. Dear Lord, Heavenly Father, we thank you once more for blessing us with information that will help us to walk on the straight and narrow path. Lord, we pray that what we've heard tonight will resonate so much so that we will embrace it and share it with others. Lord, we ask that you see us home safely. Thank you, Lord, for looking beyond our faults to see our needs. And Lord, we thank you that for you've redeemed. We look forward to this glorious city in the sky. Continue to bless our pastor as he again allows the Holy Spirit to use him. And Lord, when it's all said and done, may we all see you in joy and not in sorrow. In Jesus' precious and holy name, we humbly pray. Amen.
I'd rather have Jesus.